Welcome, everybody, to our tonight's episode of Star Trek Adventures. It is based on the Modifius system, and we're here with my amazing friends, and I'm so thankful for them. And we are going to create a story together. We are in the midst of a scene right now, and I will set it for everybody and give it sort of a mini recap on where we were, and we'll go from there. So you are on Okkos IV, O-K-K-O-S, IV, if you use that nomenclature. It is the fourth planet of the system. It is an orange dwarf star, a little bigger than the sun. That's why the fourth planet is in the Goldilocks zone. But it is an idyllic planet. It is water and jungle and beaches and homes everywhere, and from a sky view, just off in the distance, coming out of warp, is the USS Medusa, unbeknownst to the characters on the planet. However, you can see that ship has one nacelle. It's a Hermes class, USS Medusa, 71555. And so NCC 71555. I had to remember that part. Anyway, so it comes in at basically outside of the sixth planet and is just arriving. As the camera zooms in towards the fourth planet, the orange sun seems to be glowing brightly, beautiful, and it seems to have, you know, arced curves of flame, prominences coming out just along the edges as it sits there at the center of the solar system. Into the planet, blue-green world, light clouds in this section of the continent, coming down towards a beach. The beach, bright, seems somewhat silvery, actually, as it reflects the orange sunlight as we come deep into this large, metallic looking arc, artificially made structures along this beach. Some ancient technology was here before. And as you come closer, you can see many, many Okkosians lounging in their attire, enjoying the weather. It's beautiful and idyllic, nice and warm for those who like tropical. And there are beautiful buildings lined up, thousands and thousands of people all over the place. And you can see a few Starfleet officers. They're in their attire. It's almost like a tunic in their golds or blues or red uniforms, or the grays for enlisted. And as you get closer and closer, you can see that the sun is just about to rise over the horizon as we get into the evening hours, the late evening of the Okkosian day, which is relatively quick compared to standard time, about 18 hours. But as it's coming around, you can see a large building, a hall made of metal and glass, an intricate design, metallic structure. And as it goes deeper in, there's a hall. There's lines of long tables, at least 50 officers of Starfleet and many more occasions here, all sitting at this large feast tables, and at the head is a crescent where our characters are now, right now. And I will have them introduce themselves in a moment. But as you approach, there's an arc of maybe about 9 to 10th person you can see at the far end. But at the center is a large Okkosian. I call them Okkosians because it sounds funner. And they are a person, he is a person of tall build.
Is he a special occasion?
He is the special occasion tonight. Occasions are humanoid. They mostly look human. They do have ridges. Most of them have a ridge. And then the rest is smooth, very smooth along their temples. And then they look otherwise like any other human. But this occasion, Aksim, A-K-S-I-M. He is the chancellor of this place, and he has many ridges, actually. He has a prominent ridge right at the edge of his eye, and then three other ones as they taper to his cheekbone, which is high and long, as he is standing and welcoming Starfleet back again. This is their third visit here, and they're very thankful for their Starfleet to be arriving, and enjoying their rest and relaxation time here. And as Captain Blazark is sitting nearby, he motions to her and says, "Captain Blazark, we are so thankful for you and your crew to be here. We are overjoyed to be a part of this potential alliance with the Federation, and it is our whim, our glory, and our joy to welcome all of you here today. And if you wouldn't mind saying at least a few words, simply to introduce yourself, if nothing more. We are so thankful for you here. Please eat at your leisure." All right, Captain.
So she would say something. Well, first, of course, she'd stand up. She'd bow. She'd be gracious. She'd say nice things. And then she would remind them that, in fact, that she is actually a very young officer in Starfleet, and that this is her first command, and that there are certainly other people that have more wisdom and understanding about the type of occasion that we're experiencing here. But I feel very flattered at your obvious enthusiasm and graciousness, and I, to be honest, I just can't wait to get into my new ship that I've never had one of before. So
wow, thank you, Captain Blazark. We are so thankful for you and your crew. Would you like to introduce some of your command staff? There's the five of them sitting here with their fine uniforms. I don't know what you've dressed in as far as your uniforms, but the ship should be arriving at orbit in the next 3 hours, because they're not, you know, pushing it. There's a lot to discover, even in the planets in the system. Captain?
Yes, I would certainly like to take a moment to first introduce my commanding officer, Calvin Donahue, who has given us the joy of his presence, and I really, as the first time we have worked together, so I'm as interested to hear what you have to say as they are, I'm sure.
Welcome, Commander.
Nod my head and give the greeting that would be appropriate to this situation.
Bow a little bit. You've noticed as you've been assembling, and even people still slowly assembling in, because you are in a way a spectacle to them, because they don't see a lot of outsiders. There seems to be accumulating occasions here, and every time they enter this building, at least, you notice that they kind of touch their foreheads with a slight bow, and that seems like an honorific to those they meet, or of them between themselves, and also the other Starfleet personnel you have here. So you do that gesture, and the Chancellor bows and does the same thing to you, and says, "Oh, thank you so much, Commander. It's an honor to have you here, too."
Honor is mine.
And then I guess I would move on to Dr. Sihl.
Oh, well, Doctor, sorry, I didn't mean to catch you with your mouth full. Captain?
Yeah, I guess I would move on to my, I forget, Casey, what your character's name is?
Pixrin,
and your security, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so, and your rank?
I want to say it was lieutenant.
Or lieutenant commander, I think.
Lieutenant commander. I guess then we will go on to Lieutenant Commander Pixrin, who is our securities officer.
Okay. So I stand up and gesture to the pointing to the forehead, or touching the forehead lightly and bowing slightly, and say, "Thank you so much for inviting me here. It's a very beautiful home. It's a pleasure to be here."
Oh, thank you. Pleasure is ours as well.
Well, all right then. and Miniri. I forget what you're up to these days. Why don't you introduce yourself?
Miniri is a tall male Cajun. Looks somewhat like this, although with longer hair, but the gray hair is correct. And he stands up and does the gesture, the appropriate gesture, and says, I am serving as the ship's tactician, and I can also do a little engineering as needed. I'm very happy to be here and to be part of this new crew and to be hosted on such a lovely planet. Thank you so much.
Oh, well, thank you so much yourself. Yes, you were quite the talk as you jogged through when you were first arrived. So. Anyway,
Eric, you have an ALOC?
I'd been sitting in a shuttle for quite some time.
Well, hi. Hello.
Hi, Doctor.
There you are.
Yeah, he was involved in some reading on a tricorder and really wasn't paying attention the last time you talked to him. And he's
Noshing.
Yeah, so he stands up, looks a little uncomfortable. The blue Andorian, he's probably around 6 foot, fairly broad-shouldered. Looks around the room, like, you are a fascinating people. Thank you for your hospitality, and we look forward to exploring together.
Ah, yes, an explorer at heart.
Yep, yep.
Indeed.
And he sits down, going back to his reading.
Anyway, we've spoken much too long at this moment, so let us dine and as you will. Be merry, everyone. Thank you. And he takes a seat and applause and hoots and sometimes. There's a overriding feeling. A lot of them in their restful moments are they sort of coo a little bit. And then this large sort of metallic, it has these arches of metal that crisscross over all of the tables, you know, and it goes all the way down the long hall. And is like really high points that really allow the echo to go through, and they're kind of cooing, and so, but they're all different, have different voices, so they, it's kind of like a white noise, but soothing white noise.
I feel like very at home. Just, sounds like purring.
Almost, yeah, yeah. It's but it's more bird-like, but
exciting, exciting.
No pouncing.
The cat has,
however,
no pouncing on the.
My negotiation skills tell me no pouncing here.
Yeah, so does my diplomacy.
Are you going to try to challenge your value of pounce first and ask questions later?
Or I am pouncing on whatever food is in front of me.
Okay, you nosh on. They have a delicacy that is similar to what you've had at your home world, as far as presentation.
So everybody I'm pouncing has, right into the food then.
Yeah, there's lots of variety and drinks are on the house. Everything's on the house. So whatever you like. Who would like to have a scene with one of the Okkosians? You notice that there's a couple of things that I'll give again is, as the doctor and the commander Donahue know, these buildings were made from like ancient parts, basically. They are built on old foundations, and they're using this intricate glass, which has some sort of silvery substance in it that sort of gives it this energy resistance. And layered, it seemed, according to the doctor's understanding, is that this place and also the other pieces that they've seen in other establishments along the resort that is full of water sports and other kind of things, this glass seems to have some sort of resistance property to high energy particles, so really good against like radiations and those kind of things, but it seems more decorative these days. There seems to have been a history in the Okkosians about 1,000 years ago or so. Nobody knows exactly when, unfortunately. There's a dark period of time where data and knowledge was just gone. But then it's been growing on the top of those days ever since. But the Okkosians now are more, seem more simple. They have a better connection with each other. There doesn't seem like to be a lot of warlike type tendencies. They are guarded and they have structures and security things that involve with mostly shielding and that kind of thing, because this technology is ripe with that. But that metallic structure, the silver structure in the sand is also in the soil, is also in the buildings. So it's pretty much ubiquitous, at least in this area. But anyway, it's a beautiful, and you can start seeing outside the windows that there's some sort of light coming out in the sky in the direction of sunrise, and but there's still beautiful stars, and way up ahead there is an opening, like a giant dome of clear material, and at the top you can kind of see in the distance like a, just as it's leaving, a shuttlecraft leaving the surface. You guys know it's the one that you just arrived on, and you assume Lieutenant Berrios is piloting still. That's part of his duty that you know of. So he's going back up into space, probably to rendezvous with the Medusa. Anyway, what would you like to do at this point?
Do we know who has brought the Medusa here for us?
The captain of the Medusa.
Okay, so it's a captain who's
just going to switch duty here.
So we'll have to meet up with them at some point, I would assume. But
there's a reason why they're going to be staying here a few weeks after you guys. So it's pretty nice here.
I'm interested to find out what it is. The captain seemed, not the captain, their leader, Keem, before seemed kind of antsy to speak with the officers. And it seemed to have something troubling him that was going on. And for
right
me,
now, you notice that almost at least half of all the three rows of long tables are looking at this table at one time or another. And at this point, you can notice that the Chancellor has a great public figure poker face. Mm. It's not that he is faking it, per se, but it is for those who, Pixrin and also Captain Blazark, who have some sort of extrasensory. Without reading into it, Captain Blazark, you're not reading their surface thought, but you know that the Chancellor himself is feeling anxious in the way he's not exposing to everyone here. Pixrin, you know he's anxious for sure because of your empathy. So that everyone else at the table that is Okkosian does not have that sense. They're just having fun and they seem to be doing pretty good. So it seems that this guy knows something that those guys don't know something. So we're just going to go with that. So Doctor, did you say you wanted to say something or do something about with somebody?
Yes. Well, I wanted to, I'm sure everybody's had enough time to eat and,
yeah, it's time's winding, you know. It's
and we out, and I know that the crew, our crew here, is probably a little antsy for getting on the ship. So if we're diplomatically going to be wanting to have a sit down talk with their leader, maybe we should make that sooner than later. As the
you can nudge the captain or whoever.
Yeah, Medusa's arrival is nigh, and I'd be. Interested just
in all your thoughts, I guess,
just to get this moving, so that whatever regional concern he has, we can hear it at least.
Agree. Are you not going to eat that dessert then? Like, can I have it?
You go right ahead.
Awesome.
It's a gelatin of unknown origin,
yeah,
but it tastes pretty good.
I've eaten my daily caloric intake, so I don't need the extra. Thank you. But anyway, Captain.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you think it wise that we could get this conversation moving with the Chancellor?
I'm wondering if it's wise to do it at the table. It seems like, is there a you know.
Well, we can excuse ourselves and go have a talk. Yeah,
I think probably let's inquire as to maybe he could give us a little more details on the nature of the architecture of this building or something like that to have an excuse to get away from the table.
All right.
And then so I would turn to the chancellor and say, you know, I find this glasswork and this architecture, it seems like a mix of the old and the new. Could you possibly give us a little bit more of a detailed insight into it?
Oh, really? You are interested in architecture? Yes. It's a little hobby of mine, actually. But it's a really great example of our ancient ancestors' ability to take materials from this planet and beyond this planet and to make it into something new and different that's not only aesthetically pleasing, which pleases, you know, different aspects of our, you know, mental and spiritual aspects, but also our physical just presence of these types of things along with the beautiful jungles and plant life and
whatnot. Excuse me, sir?
Yes?
Might we have a little tour?
Oh, I don't want to interrupt your festivities. I don't mind chatting at the table and whatnot, but perhaps he turns to the person, young woman to his left. She has like a pad or whatnot, and she's kind of scrolling through. And I am available to speak with you in exactly 7 hours, 9 minutes, and 11 seconds.
Is that what he says?
Yes. And she looks up at you and says, do you mind if I send that information to your little devices? It's not interfering. It doesn't have a security thingamajiggy. You're welcome to see that it's just information.
I'm pretty sure that we're going to be aboard ship by that point, aren't we?
Now, the ship's not leaving for 12 hours, basically, as far as requirements, because some people, it's like scaled shore leave in a way, so the people who just arrived from the ship get maybe a day or two, or, you know, at least a few hours of transition time. So basically,
well, if he's putting us off to later, you know, as politely as possible, then what do you think, Doc? Should we just let it go for now, or you want to push him a little right where he is?
Could I get into use my negotiation skills to kind of see and feel how he's kind of coming at us with this information, and how do I feel about pushing him to kind of get into it a little bit more?
In general, the occasion seems pretty. In general, they seem polite and are very giving, but they may or may not, you know, have a role or a duty here to perform, so that might also be part of why they're doing what they're doing. But most of them seem to be just generally happy and friendly and just want to have fun, at least at this time in the day or whatever.
So their position might dictate that they need to stay here, and then maybe after the festivities.
What I'm going to do is allow you to do a thing called social conflict, in which you guys want to have more information, have a tour with this guy to get better information, and this guy just wants to blow you off and wait until the end of the day where you don't have a chance to do anything else with the information. So I'm going to allow this role. You guys can decide who leads and who I'll give you, in this case, I'll give two assists because you're at the table and you've been kind of generating this sort of momentum anyway. And so who would like to lead this speaking social conflict with the chancellor?
I guess I can step up as the captain and use my focus of diplomacy.
It's a presence command role. Who's assisting, I guess? Presence command is the main role. And if you can give me a reason not to use presence command, let me know what that would be.
I wouldn't mind helping out with negotiation command.
Yeah, because that would allow your focus to apply so that your critical range increases. So that's
good. I would also think the doctor would be the other one. That seems to be the three of us have been really trying to get this guy cornered, or politely cornered.
Is everybody else okay with that?
Okay. So, yeah, no, I have no problem helping out.
Do you want to use a presence command, or can you think of a reason to use something else that would be... Do you have any focuses that I might apply in this case to try to convince this chancellor to give you guys a real tour? Not just
unfortunately not. I'm not particularly diplomatic.
That's fine.
Or anything. I could wow him with my athletics.
I think it was your. I think it's your curiosity we admire most.
Yes.
So it also would be a presence command for you. You just wouldn't have the ability to do your use your focus to increase the critical range, but you always get, if you roll a one, you'll always get a critical success. So that's good.
Right.
So as a main role,
can you remind me how to do the rolls here, real quick?
Yep.
Discord.
We're gonna start the session. I believe where we left off. If that's all right with everybody. Which was zero momentum and 10 threat, which is how I would start any game or session, unless it's like a continuation or whatever.
Yeah, no, we don't like that because we have no momentum.
Everybody gets two, the DM gets two threat in this Star Trek Adventures module type stuff. You get two threat for each character player available. So that's five of you times two is 10. And then you start with zero momentum. So here you are. So you can, every task involved is rolls two d20s. And the number that you're trying to achieve is your attribute and your department. The attribute is one of six of them. And in this case, presence, and then the department would be command. And so you combine those numbers together. And since you have a focus of diplomacy, then you would also have a critical range of whatever your command is, because your focus allows you to increase your critical range.
Okay. How do I enter that? So I've got two D20, 14.
So it'd be 2d20, 14. What is your command?
My command is 4.
So 10, it would be 14, 4 then.
14,
so, 4. So don't put the exclamation point, but 2d20, 14, 4 would be your roll if you don't buy any dice. To what you can do is spend momentum or threat to buy additional dice to roll.
And how many dice do we need to...
The challenge I'm going to say in this case is 2, because he wants to be part of the party. It's a moderate difficulty.
So I have 2d20 to roll, and I have two people each rolling one die.
And each, and then each of the other characters, Calvin and Sihl, the doctor, will have 1d20, and then it will be the combination of their presence plus command.
Okay.
And for Calvin's roll, it would be 1d20 plus that combination, and then the last number will be the actual command itself. So say you had 3 or 4.
Okay, so I don't think we need to buy any additional, because that's four dice being rolled for 2 successes. Do I add an exclamation point at this point or not?
So
he wants you to just type it out first to make sure you get
so
it.
So I just
right
want to see it. And so hit enter once you did it. So I just wrote it out. Yeah, so Sashir's would be that for Donahue. And then Sihl, yours was probably not as good as that. And you would have a 1 or don't put anything, really. So it would be 1d20 and then whatever the combination is.
So I just enter.
Yeah, so that would be yours, 14-4. Perfect.
And do I...
Sihl would not have that. It would be 1d20, just 10, without the 4.
Oh, without the 4, okay.
So,
because you don't have a focus.
Okay. So I type this again now, right?
Gotcha. Just copy it and just put an exclamation point in front of it. And then, so nobody can assist the main role unless they get at least 1 success. So I have the main role first, and then the other ones, if applicable, usually yes, but sometimes the dice do different things. So we're going to see how well you can convince them, and you have got received one success, which is great. And the doctor does not give a success, and Sashir does not either. Oh, you've got one success between you. Does anybody have a talent that would apply that would allow you to make a reroll somehow? In relation to command, like either cautious or bold command. That was probably what happened before the roll. We can also just say that as compelling as it may seem to you, it doesn't seem as compelling to them in a way. But you do know. So does anybody have an opportunity to do that? You also can spend your determination for a reroll if that is something you want to do. You get one of those determinations per day or per session, and you have to use a value or challenge a value to make that roll. Is there anything the captain... I think the main roll would really be the only one to do that as an option.
I think that the only thing that I can think of that would be helpful would be being a telepath, where I've been sensing that there's some discomfort that he has that nobody else does. Like Casey did.
Sure.
I think I might just lean in and quietly say, something's bothering you, and you know, would you rather not talk about it at all, talk about it at the table, or talk about it later? If that gives me a reroll, I don't know if that's that, you know, like the notion that I'm gonna just, you know, be a little less circumspect, be a little more blunt.
You notice him, he raises an eyebrow, which causes his right side. They actually kind of not, you would think maybe they would just go up and down a little bit. But when he raises his eyebrow, you notice that they kind of shift and move upward along. Like they kind of pinch together a little bit, so they were wide. It's almost like it's like an enclosure almost that kind of snaps up for a moment, and then he just kind of shakes, and then it goes back to what it was. And he's like I said, just enjoy the festivities. Stay within the confines of the city, and you will be safe. And we'll have a fun time tonight. The morning will be quite eventful, and we hope you will have a great time with us. If you'll excuse me. And he stands up and leaves, and his assistant walks with him. And he bows and does his honorific to everyone that he goes by. And he cuts out a side door, the shortest path basically out. And he steps away from the table, but the festivities continue.
Oh, I'd say my diplomacy role was pretty sloppy there.
Well, you called him on it, though. You know, you called him out on it, and he didn't feel comfortable about that. That's,
You're showing your hand.
Yeah. Okay, so...
I do think that there could be more read into that stay in the city boundaries thing. That sounds rather ominous in and of itself.
Yes. And just as the attendant is leaving, I want to give you something. As she turns back to you, Captain, and you sense this as well, Pixrin, she's pleading in a way, and it says, help us, and then hurriedly follows the Chancellor. And then you're basically shutting your head and putting her eyes back on the cards or whatever, her placard. Then they're out of sight.
Is it only us at the head table now? Are there any other?
No, there's still some
occasions?
More, but they're all kind of. There's some on one. You're on one end, and you got the five of you with the captain, basically towards the center, and the chancellor and his assistant next to, and then some other ones that are within earshot, but they didn't seem to notice the conversation you guys had. So it seems like they were just chatting amongst themselves or drinking more of their liquids that they have everywhere.
I was wondering if the captain would then share what you now know with us or not.
Actually, I would probably lean into Pixarin and suggest that she might, as a security officer, do a just a check of the area, maybe specifically where those two just went, and see if they're safe and that we're all safe and secure. Because I think that Pixarin's got the right read to be able to, you know, perhaps at least let them know that there's an empathic ear. Sympathetic ear. So, Pixarin, you want to go do that?
Neri can also jump in to do something similar, and we can just say that Pixarin is going with to do that, and then
happy to help.
We can go from there.
Yeah. Why don't you do a tour of the facilities and see what the Chancellor and his assistant are up to.
Okay, so, Maneri casually stands and stretches and grabs a drink and sort of meanders towards the door. Maybe, assuming Pixarin is coming along, we'll just walk together, making it sort of look like we're just taking a bio break or something.
Okay, so as you stand up and start kind of heading in that general direction, you see a couple people come from some, like, the edges of the long tables. They have this, I guess they will call it fangirl, fanboy kind of look. Big giant eyes, and they're just like, "You're a giant captain, can I bet you? Oh, you're a cute little Orion lady. Oh," they're just enamored by your differences from their, they're all different shades, but usually fur covered and green are not them, or blue for that matter, Doctor. So you do have your own fans of interest, but it seems to at least be it for each of you, at least five, and if not more for the Cation.
Greet them in my usual friendly manner, and maybe like.
But they are making it a little slower to get through. There's actually at least three deep right now towards the door.
Well, I'm going to let them, I'm just going to greet them friendly in a friendly way, maybe take a couple selfies, whatever they're into.
Okay, yeah, they have these little devices. It's probably this size, and it has like an enclosed propeller-like thing, but it seems to be using magnetism rather than the air itself, but it's moving around, and it just kind of, you want to do a selfie or whatever, it kind of takes a picture, but it kind of does a scan of everybody in the area. Really, it's not that far, like maybe a meter from itself. And it just takes a quick snapshot of everything that's happening right there. And then it's like a memory bank that they can share with each other. And it kind of goes around and people have access.
Yeah, that's some snazzy social media device stuff you got going on there.
Oh. Yeah, but anyway, it's just, just for fun. And yeah. So look at the neat thing I found.
I'll be friendly and, give it a few minutes. And then I'll be like, I kind of got to make my way to the, got a dash.
Okay. I'm going to make this a difficulty one roll.
To get away.
It's sort of a, not, if you power through, then that's a different thing than guide yourself through or whatnot. So who is going, actually? I know Maneri and Pixarin.
I think it was just the two of us doing our security thing.
Doctor,
I'm looking to use their, I don't feel like following the, following the representatives there, but I am interested in seeing what kind of dangers are outside the city. Not that I want to go outside the city, but I do want to go to the edge of the city and try to get some tricorder readings and see what actually might be going on outside the borders, as I do have a belief that this area is has been altered from a much less safe planet. This area has been very sculpted by some intelligent, force to be much safer from what element we don't know. Is it just, cosmic radiation getting through the atmosphere, or is it something else more going on? So I would like to go.
I would say that the two of you, you think your best bet to get past this throng, which is starting to encroach and surround you, Doctor, if you kind of stick together, the three of you, you think you can kind of carve your way through. I'm going to make it a difficulty one. And I think it's sort of also a social conflict. So I wouldn't say command presence, because you're not trying to order them around or trying to force them to do anything. Maybe it's more subtle than that. Maybe you're trying to reason with them or you're insightful. So if you can give me a reason to use something other than, I think your presence would be involved.
About present security, because I'm really trying to also.
Yeah, in that case, I think that would be true.
Keep myself like aware.
Okay, who wants to assist, I guess? And who wants to lead? Percy wants to lead the path through the throng.
If Pixarin is going with you, she has composure. And
composure, she could lead. Presence command would be her role as well. Doctor,
Yeah, present security.
I do have,
security. I mean,
she's president. Yeah. She's present security on
the. Yeah. President.
Yeah. And I also have security at level three. And
So yeah. I think that your combinations would work great.
You could act as a shell, as it were, to deflect the attention away from them long enough for them to get
away. Actually, as you're doing that. You notice the Saurian, one of your officers, he's a science officer. He's walking towards your throng, and he starts turning the heads of a couple of them, of your throng. So he's just going to kind of stand there, and, you know, and he's not even interacting with you, like you're not even there. He's just interacting with the occasions, and some of them are like, he's paying attention to me. Oh, my God. So they just do that. You just notice it's subtle. I'm not going to give an assist or anything. It's just something like that. So what I'm going to do is allow you to do the roll. Who wants to lead? I guess that was the question. Manir, do you have something?
What is Pixarin? I have a presence 9, security 5.
Yeah, she's presence 9, security 4, so you should lead.
Okay. I also have composure, so I can do that part.
Oh, good. Yeah, but you can both use that. Do you have something that would help, Doctor?
I have my presence and security. That would total of 11.
Okay. And do you have a focus that would apply, like composure or anything like that? Fandom?
No. Fandom?
Wrong crossing?
I have athletics if it's a matter of,
if you
like,
have to, you start, you know, throwing your body around, dodge, then
yeah,
you can definitely knock him around.
Stretches so well.
Yeah.
Okay, proposed role in the Discord chat. So.
Without spending any threat or momentum, then that would be your role. 2d20, 14.5. Maneri, go ahead and roll that. And then we'll see if we need to set up the helper rolls. Yes, you got a success. Two successes.
Two successes!
Okay. And then Pixrin's roll would be... Yep, that's right. 1d20, 13.4. Alas, almost a critical. Failure. and then, Doctor, are you, what is your 11? It would just be 11 then.
Yeah.
1d20, 11.
Yeah.
Success. So you got three total successes. Nice. You can spend stuff for rerolls and all that kind of fun stuff, but otherwise, you would gain two momentum. So I'm going to increase your momentum.
Yay, team!
And that's our new number.
So talents are only for who's the main lead, right?
Yes. Yeah. In this case, yeah. All right, so I'll tell you, describe what happens. So it seems like it's true, as Pixarin noticed even earlier when you first arrived. All Federation officers had a bounty of occasions fawning over them, just because of their differences to them, but also their like similarities or maybe their interests or whatever coincided. And they could talk for hours about poetry, or they could talk for hours about, you know, quantum science or whatever. But, you know, there's just so many different types of occasions here, but a lot of them are just kind of fawning over you guys. And as you're slowly making your way towards the door, with the Saurian sort of acknowledging that you need to leave kind of thing, basically took a couple of them off you and kind of the ones closest towards the door. So there's two instead of three. And then as you're slowly, yes, absolutely. You kind of spread your arms as wide as you can and make a path for the doctor. And, you know, on the other side is Pixarin making a path. And then you're all kind of working together to make your way. And you make it out the door. And there's long, they're not mazes, but there's hedges and long hallways of different metal and stone. And then along, there's it's very open on the right side that leads down towards all the beaches and stuff. And then the far end, on this open side, you can see the Chancellor and his aide, and you can see that four other occasions kind of meld from the crowd into falling in place behind them as they make their way. There's another building past there, and you can also see that there's like either a tram system or the pneumatic tubes attached to the next building over, so it seems like they could be anywhere in the city in a few more moments. So you have a little bit of distance because the occasions kind of slowed you up. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to say that he's at extreme range, but still within whatnot range of view. You believe you can probably sprint about halfway to the distance to make you medium distance. That's two ranges.
But we don't want to attract attention.
That you think because of the distance between where you are and then extreme range, even at medium range, he's probably not going to notice you. Or if you pull up just behind a bush, there's plenty of things to kind of stop behind. And so even if you did make a noise or whatnot, then there's a lot going on. There's still parties, there's still music, there's still dancing, there's still cheering everywhere. So it would be hard to notice that if you stop at medium range. And then you'd be able to.
Dr. Sihl, are you going to go with us to follow the Chancellor, or are you going to do your own thing?
And you notice, let me quick finish in that reference. Doctor, on the left side is the hedges, and you notice it kind of goes and is like an arboretum botanical type thing and a lot of kind of mechanical stuff. It also leads towards the jungle edges and also towards the end of the city. And you've studied the map enough to know that this point is almost central, but there's because it's kind of crenellated, the inner crenellation towards the edge of what the city is close to this area. So if you think you head to the left, you would be able to make that. Yeah. It's more than extreme range, but it took you a few moments to get there.
All right. I think I'll leave the stealthing to the couple of you. You'll be much better at than I would. I'm going to be going to the edge of the city. I should be fine. I'll radio in anything I discover.
He's going to go science the shit out of that stuff.
I'm going to science the shit. That's right.
All right. We're going to be sneaky.
Okay, so the three of you have done something. What is the captain and commander doing at the table?
I sent you a message and thing. I was just going to hang out with the captain and work the crowd with my diplomacy and my composure and stuff. And just kind of see if I can kind of work my way and listen to conversations from the kind of higher ups that are around us to see if maybe I can glean a little bit more insight as to, you know, the culture and what's happening around here and all that stuff.
Yeah, I think, agree with him. I think glad handing is a good idea.
Well, you do notice a bunch of slightly disappointed occasions looking at the door where your team has just left. And then, you know, some of them, you know, are already standing waiting for you to come off your away from your table. But you notice that some of the other ones are still interested in the two of you, even though you're humanoid looking.
Come on, I'm half Betazoid, half Falcon.
Captains, so they have some more intrigue than perhaps the Huon, but still, humans definitely don't have the ridges or anything like that. That's cool.
I will make their day by being around them.
Absolutely.
Me too. Me too.
All right. So,
tits up and everything. Up,
head over towards that direction, and immediately the occasions are, you know, fawning over you and very excited to talk to you and asking questions. Most of them are inane. And, You know, are, you know, where are you from? You're from two different planets. So you have different parents. Oh, AMG. You know, that kind of stuff. What I'm going to say now is, as an aside from that sort of the distraction-y part, I'm going to say that Commander Donahue positioned themselves in a such a way that at the end of the table where the remaining four occasions were, I think that's the right number, sitting in, you know, sitting amongst themselves and whatnot, so you can actually overhear a little bit of the conversations. The universal translator of your comms is working fine, and you can understand them.
I also have linguistics and xenoanthropology, if that helps at all.
Can we turn our universal translators up loud enough to hear conversations farther away? Is that part of their technology?
You could adjust your comm badge, whoever is listening, to transmit it to receive. You can enhance it somehow to make it so you can hear better in a certain area and then transmit it as normal to somebody else, if you want to, so that the captain can hear what Calvin's comm is doing. But I will make it an engineering roll, just difficulty one, so control engineering. And only one of you can work on this. And since it's Donahue's badge, I would assume it would most likely be your thing. And you have tools, and you have the basic stuff with you. So if you just adjust your tricorder and you can, Etta can speak to your comm badge, you can adjust its parameters to do this. But it's going to take a little finagling to do it while you're standing here being fawned over by a bunch of people. Like, oh, what are you doing? Oh, those are pretty lights. Oh, what, oh, well, that's an interesting arc. What is he going to do? Yeah, so there.
Is he hearing anything of value to make it
I will fun? Tell you in a moment what you have this thing done. It would be 2d20 because you are the instigator. You can roll, if you spend one momentum, you can gain an additional die, and that will be give you 3d20.
Do we have momentum?
How about I use Spirit of Discovery that gives the entire group the momentum pool of three, extra three?
If you want to spend your determination right now, is that what you're saying?
Does the pool go away, or do we keep those three if I engage that Spirit of Discovery?
The momentum is in your pool until you use them.
So if I do that, then we'll have three extra momentums then.
Three extra, or you could just spend the momentum we have and try to gain them.
You can also gain them from your roll. If it's difficulty one and you roll three dice, what is your focus that you're using to, in this case?
On this particular one, I'm doing espionage.
Espionage to do...
Over here and listen to conversations that are further away to kind of tweak calm things so I can understand.
Yeah, I would say that you know some of the less used, or how would you say, less they're frowned upon uses, I should say, for general use, but you know that there are frequencies and functions that you can use. So I'll allow it this time. So did you want to spend one of your momentum for a die?
Yes.
You can also spend threat if you want. Do you have like cautious or bold engineering in this case?
As far as focuses?
Or... As a talent.
Oh, talent I was going to use. I either have constantly watching, veteran, quick to action, or spirit of discovery in my talents.
Those won't apply necessarily in this role. Okay, So it doesn't matter whether you spend momentum or threat. Spend a momentum for a die. Okay.
So that's three dice for a one die roll. So nice.
Excellent. Three successes.
Nice.
So gain two momentum back.
Is somebody keeping track of that?
Awesome.
Yep.
I am. The GM does.
I'm putting it in the group chat.
Okay, I see it now.
So yeah. I hear everything.
So what I've allowed this to do is you've adjusted such that you're carrying it on an uncommon frequency to the captain's priority one signal in his comm badge, her comm badge, such that she can hear the muted conversations of the occasions and what you overhear. Most of it is sort of inane, just like, oh yes, you know, it's been, we've had a good year this year, oh yes, oh yeah, oh well. And so they're sort of like governors or people of interest, one of them is from Zimville, and he says something under his breath about the Bayul tournament is later on tonight, starting at dawn, so I can't wait to be there, don't miss it. I have all my eggs in one basket for the Thrashers, and there's nothing you can dissuade me for, no matter how much money you give me, to change my bet. And the other one next to him is like, there's no way the Planeteers are going to just totally take them over, and there's no way that they can win the tournament.
This is like a cultural sport.
It seems like a cultural event that's happening. And so, can you say your question again? You were kind of brief.
I was just seeing if it was a cultural sport or if this is a known sport.
It's a cultural sport. It's not something you recognize, but now that you think of it, it's spelled differently than it sounds. It's a B-A-J-O-U-L-E, but it's Bayul. And the game is basically... it's almost sort of the basic capture the flag kind of thing. You grab you've seen billboards, and you've seen like telescreens of sporting events and water sports and all sorts of things. But you recall there's it's a giant stadium, and you can recall from the map that there was like, you know, the arcway where the crenellated beaches are, and that's where all of the residents usually are, and then towards the center of this spoked half circle is where you are now at the hall, and then on another portion it goes towards like the unpopulated jungle and mountainous regions, and the other side is sort of the sort of an oval stadium type thing, and that's just outside the semicircle is a big giant stadium where the Bayul tournament is. They've had billboards and stuff about it.
Thinking back, are we going to be? We're not even going to be here at dawn. We're supposed to be.
Well, you are basically at 0600 is when you're allowed to go back up. But it's not scheduled to leave till noon, basically. Your duty route. So you have. Basically the rest of the day, probably you got another 9 hours or so.
9 minutes.
So that'll be around and available. People are just going to stay up all night and just do it. You notice that a lot of people have different team colors on, sort of, but it's subtle. It's not like it's, I have a jersey of, the Thrashers, it's green, white, and black. So they have sort of these almost like, not epaulets, but, scarves and, I would say epaulets and maybe little trinkets on in their hair or whatever that kind of represents.
The Thrashers versus who?
One of the other teams. It's a multi-team thing. It's not one versus one. It's everybody for themselves. It's a free-for-all sort of, but it's a team-based thing. And each one has a, that each team has a prize that represents their team in one form or another. It's not the actual prize itself necessarily. It can be depending on the object, but usually it's something sphere size that can be, if somebody has a large enough hand, can probably palm easily, almost like a maybe a little bit bigger than a softball, or maybe a little bit smaller than like a candlepin bowling ball. But it's something that's, holdable and hideable and whatever. But the goal is to, get the items, and then the other is protect your own items. So basically, as you go, you can start accumulating them as you go, and then the winner is the one that has the remainder of them. And so it's a exciting sport. So you can tell that they're fairly into it. But for the most part, you can't notice. You don't notice anyone acting out of sorts. Most of them seem to be just focused on their conversations, and some of the governors notice you or notice that you're nearby, but they don't strike up a conversation with you, especially since the chancellor left so abruptly. They seem to be like, okay, we'll just leave it at that, and he can deal with them. But for the most part, I will say, I will give you a one tidbit of information, and then if you spend a momentum, I'll give you a second tidbit of information. So the first bit of information is free, and this information essentially is the Okkosians have an event coming up in the morning. It's not at 6 o'clock, but it is in the morning, and it is something that is anticipated by them, that is part of the conversations that you're overhearing. You are kind of distracted with the people in front of you, but essentially there is an event happening that is very monumental to the Okkosians, and everybody's excited about it, but you're not sure why. And then if you spend a momentum, I will tell you one other bit of information that will help you a little bit more if you want.
Is the comm that I have, the way I hooked it up, so my commander is also, my captain is also hearing what I'm hearing, correct?
Yeah, that is how you set it up, yeah.
Okay, then I'm going to talk to the commander, the captain, sorry.
You're standing next to each other, actually, so.
You want to spend the momentum and get some more information, or do you think this is kind of not worth it?
I have never not wanted more information.
All right, so I guess we'll spend more information. We'll spend some more information then. I mean, some.
Yes, we will spend one of our momentum to get the other tidbit that you are dangling in front of us.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Dangle it!
Oh, wait. What are we dangling again? Moving on.
Participles.
Okay, so gaining more information. Captain, using your telepathic ability, one of the governors seems to be more of an open book than the other ones, in the sense of his mental thoughts, and it's just, you can't help but overhear because he's so freaking loud. And what you notice is his thoughts about the upcoming time are almost, I guess I'll put it in the most genteel time, zealot. He is excited for the event coming up.
No,
so
this
excited,
event is...
in fact, exaltation. It is a monumental, miraculous event.
You said there was an event coming up, but you also said there was a sporting event that started in the morning.
The sporting event is something that they're talking about, but the event itself that's been implied is after that.
Okay.
But it's a culmination of the event that they're participating in right now. So the games themselves are potentially a part of what they're exalted about.
Would this be like a regime change or something that could possibly occur following these games? Just from looking at my cultural anthropology and my espionage and infiltration type past.
Yeah, speculation wise, many cultures have many ceremonial events for many different things, infinite possibilities in this case. But you do know that the sporting event seems to be part of it, and that you know that everybody is excited about it.
Now, the zealotry, is it the flavor of the zealotry? Is it like, is it
it's
like
not,
religious?
It doesn't seem malicious. It just
is it religious,
like,
or is it ecstatic? Or
ecstatic, exalted, like a miracle kind of thing. Like this is going to be the best thing ever in my whole existence. I can't wait.
What team's he voting for on the surface?
what's he
talking to his friends about?
So the planeteers are black and red, colored, and then the green, white, and black of the thrashers is pretty prominent, probably 50-50 of the ones that are doing it. And then there's smatterings of, you know, 10% or less of the rest of them have, you know, their own special things. Some of them has gold circuitry and weird kind of shapes and designs to sparkle their no-name teams. But any team is allowed to join, and it's like a four-person team, so there's no, you know, nobody's going to be, oh, it can be four or less, I mean, depending on your team. And they're, but you can't, the guy that was thinking it seemed to be one of the Thrashers fans. But he wasn't the one gushing over it about the bet or anything like that. He was quiet and reserved in the conversation verbally, but telepathically he was had a lot going on.
So. All right.
And that's where you guys are. You're being fawned over. Oh, Captain. Oh, tell us about your starship. Oh, mm-hmm. We'd love to have a tour if we have a chance. When is it arriving? Do you remember? Oh, I remember I saw something fiery. Was that little one yours too? You know, stuff like that.
You want to see my room?
Sure. Wow. A couple of them say.
Nice action. I like that. What I was going to say is I'm probably going to, I don't know, casually ingratiate myself with someone enough to find out who the bookies are around here.
Oh, sure. Let's go back to the chase.
You're using yours to get somebody up to your room, and you're upset with me for
that. Are you betting on the games?
Totally betting on the games.
Are you betting on the games, or are you betting on Calvin's success with this endeavor? Yeah,
right. Oh, I know better than to bet against Calvin.
All right, so not a scene change, but a continuation of where we were a moment ago. You both had a chance to do your thing, and they did their escape, and now they're chasing after, in a way, the governor. You all have a chance to run, walk, shuffle, roll, however you want to. But you believe that, you know, if you don't get within at least shouting distance or conversation distance, or if you're trying to hide from them, you might lose them when they enter the building. Which they're approaching. So what are you doing right now? I'll let you guys have the lead. I'm going to make it combat format, so everybody's going to have a turn, but we're going to ping-pong back and forth. But you guys get the con right now.
So I'm going to suggest that Pixarin and us, and I mean, we just had a little side conversation with the doctor, and he was going to go off his own way, so that happened. I suggest we sprint up to medium range and then just sort of walk casually. I mean, how casual can we be when we're like super obvious to the
you kids, have been known to run around this place already, so
that is true.
It might be your common way of running around, and your friend is running with you.
Yeah, so, we're jogging.
So I would allow you, without doing anything else, allow you to do a move action, which is to run, and then a sprint, which takes up a move and an action itself. So both of those things that you guys can do. So Maneri, you can go first, or Casey go first in this case. But if you're going to do the sprint action, it takes both of the things you can do in this round, and then it will be their turn to move. Okay. Or you can spend a momentum to retain the initiative, and that will allow Casey to also move in this case, or the doctor could also move, or the captain, or Calvin. But in this case,
I think let's have Casey and I move because we're going together.
So you and Pixarin will both are working together, and
working together.
I'm gonna have you spend the momentum,
okay?
Retain initiative. You're down to one momentum, FYI.
Okay.
And I'm going to allow both of you to sneak up, basically, or run up to medium range. And then, since you can only have two of you go at one time, it is now their turn. They are not sprinting because they are walking casually. So you've actually gained quite a bit, but they are going to move their normal movement, one movement. So now they're at long range from you, from medium, because you went from extreme to long to medium, two movement spots. And now they are moving from medium to long, one movement spot in their normal movement turn. So I'm just going to, they're kind of together.
Pursuit yet?
No.
They have not yet acknowledged pursuit or noticed they're being pursued.
Is picturing getting anything from her empath abilities that they are kind of like freaking out that we're behind them or anything like that?
Okay, yeah, I would say I would give picturing that just before they go on her turn, you're just reaching medium range so that, yes, you can sense things at a long range that, yep, they're there. But at medium range, I would say that she would get a pretty good idea of the emotional state of them and focus most likely on the Chancellor, who seems not visibly distraught, but distraught. He's basically worried a lot. And the residual people around him seem to be trying to support him in one way or another, either using their the assistants using her pad to try to relay information to calm him down, and then the other ones are just there for the presence. But generally, Pixman notices that. I'll give you that.
I'll relay that to Nura.
Okay. I suggest that our intention is going to be, I realize it's not our turn, but just to let you know, is to keep doing this, like doing our little jog thing and kind of keep up with them, but not in a way that will alarm them.
Okay.
If survival helps that, I don't know if it does or not as far as...
On the next round, I will let you sprint up again, but then I'm going to have to make a stealth roll to hide the stomping feet from sprinting.
Stomping? I have soft paws, dude.
Yeah, but you will be within short range, so somebody running up on you, you're going to kind of notice.
It's like the little click when the cats walk on the linoleum.
Yeah, even your soft paws...
You're always ready to pounce.
Yeah, exactly.
Mass.
So they cut quickly to the doctor.
Slice the shit out of it, Doc.
Okay, so you walk away from the... starts getting darker and darker and cooler towards the forest, which you're thankful for. It's still humid, but, you know, it's not as blasting as it was earlier. But as you approach the edge... you notice that, you know, there's gardens, you know, maintained gardens, and there's kind of like sort of fields that are, you know, mowed every once in a while or hayed once in a while or whatever. But as you start getting denser vegetation and trees and critters, bugs and animals and birds overhead and things like that, and you notice that it really starts turning more like a country road, and when you're very close to the edge, and then right in the middle of the path, you're crossing right over. It's sort of well trodden, but it's not well. It's like a cut across. Like there's a field or an edge of some place that most people. There's no sidewalk. The sidewalks around the edges, but people cut across. So this is like a cut across. So you're basically straight out towards the jungle. You know that there are lights and there are towns and stuff further ahead, but just in this area, it seems very. Natural and but yeah, so, and as you approach right at the edge, it's not lying, that map is actual depiction of a mechanical carve between two places in the ground, right. At least 10 meters on each side, so it's a metallic ball, strip that you see there's a little gap, there's vegetation growing in there too, but there's like dirt and whatever, and then it kind of curves around towards the coast and it turns around this way towards one of the spokes and starts coming back up again and then comes back around, and but then the, you know, the path is trod and it keeps going further in. What would you like to do?
I'm fascinated at the division. And I want to see the composition differences of the soil or whatever it's made of, whatever the ground is. You know, what is this difference? And try to ascertain why there's a difference. You know, what kind of function with this?
Okay.
you know, why is there that, you know, someone went through the process of doing this, so what point is there? You know, it's not blocking anything from the sky. It's not, you know, so what is the function?
Okay, so I'll give you a insight science roll or a reason science roll. And it would be difficulty 2, but since you're using a tricorder, it decreases the difficulty by 1 down to 1. So it's difficulty 1 with either your insight reason plus your science.
All right, insight.
And do you have any sort of focuses that would apply to...
A lot of my focuses have to do with medicine. I'm very interested in xenobiology.
Okay.
Infectious diseases, virology. So if there's some kind of...
If you're doing it for the biological aspects differences, yeah. I would let you do xenobiology
sure.
with at cost, which would increase your difficulty range by 1. So they might give you misinformation potentially, but it will allow you to use your xenobiology as a focus.
Yeah, because, I mean, that's really where I'm going to be focusing on this kind of stuff.
Okay, and I'm going to spend 2 threat to increase your difficulty range by 2 more.
Oh, that's your claim.
Okay, so... you have 1 momentum, and I'm down to 8 threat. I don't know why you guys aren't giving me threat. So I'm going to tell you what your range is. So your initial roll is 2d20... And then what is your total for your combined?
We're talking insight and science, or are we doing...
Or reason science.
Reason science.
Whatever's better.
That's, it's going to be the same thing. So that'll be a 13?
13. Okay, so then it'll be 13, and then whatever your science is, which is what, 4 you said?
My science is 4, yep. Yeah.
And then your difficulty range would be 17. So I'll type it up, but it'd be 2d20.
And we have a momentum to spend, so let's spend it.
All right.
So right, this is just the initial.
Yeah, so it'd be 2d20.
You said 13 was your combo, right?
Yep.
So, and 4 is your science. So that's your initial roll, and you can spend momentum to gain a roll, gain another die.
Yeah, we'll do that. We have solid momentum here, so we'll
all right. And there wasn't a difficulty increase, it was a complication range increased. Sorry, I'll edit that.
Alright.
And so you would just now be 3d20 with that rest of that stuff.
Alright.
Oh, I gotta spend the momentum. All right.
3d20.
Yeah.
Nice.
Awesome.
Nice.
There we go.
3 successes.
That's how we do it.
And 1 complication. So you can spend 2 momenta. You've gained, it's difficulty 1, so you've gained 2 additional momenta.
All right.
And also a complication. You can squash this complication by spending 2 momenta. So then it will be 0 for both of us. Change. Or you could take the 2 momentum and also take the complication.
Yes.
Yes. All right.
Yeah.
Yes, for there's 2 of them. So
yes. Well, let's take the second one. Let's take it all. We're going to take the momentum and complication.
Hey-o! Okay, what are we talking about again?
Yes. 2 successes.
Yes, all of it. 2 successes.
2 momentum,
okay,
and,
2 momentum and 1 complication.
1 complication. And that's your science guy. He's doing his best out
I'm
there.
I'm just
going to
take
the
complication as a threat.
That's right.
I can increase my threat. So,
increase his threat. Be a little threat monger.
That's all right.
What?
What?
So you're now there. 2 momentum, 9 threat.
Wouldn't seem right with you, but I will.
See, he had 10 threats, so he had to spend some. So
yeah.
We
yeah.
got more than he
I'm
got.
I'm down 1 still. Yeah. And you're still, and now you're up 2. All right. What I'm going to do is tell you the basic information that your scanner will tell you, and then you can spend momentum to gain additional information up to three can be spent in this way. You can also spend threat in replace of it. And that'll give you more information as we go. But your initial scans, the silver substance seems to be not only in the metal structure, but also in the plants themselves, in the soil itself. It seems to be pretty ubiquitous everywhere, in a way. And it's not just that it's there, but it's actually a part of the structure. Like, it has become a necessary component of the biological structure of these plants, and even some of the bugs and birds have this component about them. Not all of them, but a lot of them seem to have developed an affinity or a relationship with this silver type metal.
All right. When you say silver type metal, is this a known metal?
It is.
Does it try hard to identify it?
You would understand it as a silver alloy. How about that? But the other part of the material does not correspond to known stuff. And you can notice that because the metal is made of this, the giant structure with the gap is made with some of the structure or alloy in it, then it would seem to you that this is sort of just here. It's one of the raw materials that came with the planet, and it's everywhere almost. And so it doesn't seem necessarily a bad thing or a toxic thing, but what long-term effect on humans, you don't know, or any other species of the Federation. But the occasions seem to be fine, and they seem to be a part of it too, from what you've noticed. So.
But it doesn't seem natural the way it's being. I mean, it seems to have been introduced later on. This is not something that was. I mean, the fact that
it was not, you don't believe it was a genetic development as more as an environmental synergy.
Okay.
They're not dying from whatever it is, but it seems to be part of a lot of things around here.
Oh, myself. Well, let's do. You said I could get some more insights.
Yeah, you can have up to three questions or three more information gains per momentum. So one momentum per new information. And you can do it now. If not, then we'll go to the next turn.
Basically. All right. Well, let's do one now. I'm looking for what is the threat? You know, how is this potentially tied into the threat of why we shouldn't leave these limits? What is it when I cross this line that puts me in danger outside of, you know?
What are the differences?
Yeah, what is the difference? Why is it that I'm protected on this side but not over here? Are there beasties around? Are there, like, creatures in the woods, the jungle?
Your study of the biology, the differences of why it's on either side. From your scans and from your knowledge of biology and especially xenobiology, where everything grows differently in different circumstances, the circumstances here seem to be enough for you to notice that on the side you started with, where you are, where the resort is, all that stuff, that seems to be old growth trees, and on the other side seems to be new growth trees. And new, relatively speaking, these are, you know, 200 years old, and these are 100, you know, like 100 years old or whatever. But there's ones that are in this side that are 1,000 years old, and there's ones on that side that are still 200 years old or whatever. So you notice there's like there's, it's almost like a preservation in this area on this side of it. And it just seems like this is like trying to incorporate a version of the ecosystem of the area. Doctor, we were just finishing up your analysis of the area.
Nice.
What I would say from your keen observation is that there is a difference between inside, you would say, this arc and outside, even though is a lot of common stuff nowadays. It's been many generations of growth on both sides, but you definitely know that the inside seems to have been more well preserved than the other side.
Is there my mind goes to a possibility that are there residents who live outside the borders?
Yeah, there's towns and stuff out there.
Okay, I have to wonder, is there like another class of people there? You know, does living outside of the borders make you susceptible to some kind of genetic altering? You know, component, or am I just?
You're pining at your tricorder. Yeah. I wish you could tell me these answers.
Yeah, exactly.
Alas, your scanning range is not enough to tell me the information about their genetic makeup.
Yes, and I've only got a few hours here, and it's not that important.
You do notice that there is a difference.
How about the
the socioeconomic differences? That might exist on either side, but
wouldn't the Federation have some information?
I would have thought they would have checked this out and they would have noticed.
Like,
wouldn't we be
able to look at like Federation info to find some of this?
You could do a search, Doctor. Connect to the your tricorder has basically the information you have, but it's not as in depth as your computers would be on the ship once it arrives.
Sure.
But once you have the availability, even at a distance, you could patch in and start having access to that data, and then you could compile to see the records that the captain speculated about. But
are we close enough to patch in yet?
We're just what?
Are we close enough to patch into the ship yet?
Possibly. You haven't tried yet. So, Captain and
Doctor, give it a shot.
Donahue.
Yeah.
Yep, I will let that be your next action.
Yeah,
so, the two of you, what are you going to do in the quick moment, Doctor? You're going to try to attempt to contact the ship and whatnot?
Yeah, I'm going to see if we're in range yet and try to establish communication so I can access.
I'll let you do that in a moment. Let everybody have a brief moment for each round.
Yep.
It's not exactly the same amount of time character in the character wise, but they're approximately concurrent until you get back together, and then it'll be when that happens.
Yes. So as I recall, Calvin, you were trying to get laid, and I was trying to place a bet.
Okay, so Calvin Donahue, you are welcome to go anywhere with these people as you want. There's plenty of places. You have your own place, not far from here, but all of them are not far from here, FYI.
That's so very the original series, right?
Yeah. Well, do you straddle the chair like Riker or whatnot? Anyway, to the each your own. But yes, there are plenty of people here willing to join you and have more fun, because there's lots going on, and pick your variety of entertainment.
I'm just being social and just kind of interacting with the people, and just kind of getting seeing the hype around the games that are going to be happening, and just kind of say, like, you know, what's colors or what, you know, who's what, and you know, just
trying to teach you the game or something.
Yeah, just kind of like act like I'm really interested in like sport type things, and just kind
of listen to our sport ball game. Oh my gosh, you'll love it.
You have
it's unlike any sport ball game in the galaxy.
You have the goals in the hole in one.
Go local sports franchise.
Yes, holes in one. No, not in this game, but there are other games where that could be part of it, I'm sure. Let's check out the screen, and then one of your three new friends walks up to the screen, and she touches it and says, okay, this is how it works. And they all have, each of them, one of them has Thrasher, and the other two have what did I call them? The planet sides or whatever. Planeteers.
Planeteers, Thrasher.
Thrashers and Planeteers. Those are the two main ones, but there is probably 1,000 different games happening simultaneously throughout around the area. You notice this actually gives you a more detailed map of the world that you are currently in, and you recognize that there are underground connectors, and all along those there's like a color that represents this area. And so then there's Oxnard, which is where the arena is being held, and that's where that's a area in this it actually looks like a circle. It's differentiated differently than in the maps in your rooms, because it seems like the maps in your rooms are just generic. This is the resort area, enjoy, you know, and touch this area for food or entertainment or whatever. But this is a detailed map of the rivalries between different groups, where it represents the Thrashers, represents the Planetaries, and there's like a whole bunch of other teams of varying toughness. And think of it like horse racing. Everybody has like odds to win, and the clear favorites are the Thrashers.
Handicaps.
Yeah, essentially, yeah.
But did you say there were underground tunnels?
Yeah, because what you notice is not the surface of this planet's shape like you expected on the map, but you see this underground structure where each one of these circular nodes of this place is represented by the Planeteers. But they have their little cute little symbol. It looks like a glowing planet and that kind of stuff. And then Thrashers are the next biggest town over, and you know they're adjacent, but there's these tube systems, so it's not just the cog.
So every town is a circle, and there's
tubes in a way, and the most populous ones seem to be, and they have these circular things, and then it goes to about halfway, maybe a little bit more, depending on how popular the team is. Influence along these lines and connect and interconnect every one of the other ones. So you can get to any other place on this continent. But it's shaped, it has the shape of the continent, so it's like a league championship type thing, whatever. But each place has a representative in this grand bowl, which is happening at a culmination right now. And so they basically explain that in not so many terms, but basically that's the gist of what it is. But the game itself, there's hundreds of games going on right now. They've been going on for months, and this is towards the grand finals, and anybody who makes it on the outlying towns championships gets jumped into the pool for the finals.
So
the finals already are dominated by the two major teams and then dozens of others.
Is there anything other than like the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat, or what happens, for example, if the Thrashers win?
They'll get all the prizes forfeited by the teams in the match.
Other than that, is there anything else that is resulted by this? I mean, I see the colors on the map. Do the colors on the map change if they win?
You don't know. You're not even asking a good question. It's Calvin.
Oh, I'm sorry. My bad. I thought I was with Calvin.
Were you following the three of them, the four of them?
Oh, no, that's right. You guys walked away. No,
you were going to go find a bookie. So
my bad.
I'm going to let you do it a second.
My bad. Sorry.
Yeah, I'm being social.
All right. So you're discovering information.
This information should be relayed anyway.
You can write up a report real quick and throw it on, you know, like try to take notes while you're doing it. Just it's like, oh, and then, you know, so you get the information. You can get a free download of all the bets and ways you can join in. But the fun thing is that anybody can participate, and they can put their coins towards whatever teams that they think are going to win. And that pot, a portion of that goes towards the teams that you're supporting. So that you're literally helping the team that's playing. So okay. However you...
I will.
They do that. That's why they're so invested in it, because they're actually investing in their well-being, I guess.
All right, then I'll just if there's like something that kind of shows that, I'll take a copy of that and just kind of.
Oh yeah, those pamphlets.
Everybody.
Free information everywhere. Kiosks, you can get any information that you really want on these caves. But the most striking thing, as far as the map that you know of, is that there's more cities connected underground than, you know, like, just past the cities, there's not a lot. I mean, there's a lot. There's towns and people and whatever. But it's there. And then inside each of these things, they seem to be similarly shaped, at least in their core, different sizes, radiuses, and stuff. But they're encapsulating different areas. And then
I'll transfer that information once I have it. So I'm looking at it. Just give it out to everybody so they can have the maps, they can see what's going on, and the captain can decide who he wants to bet on.
Great. Yeah, actually,
those maps might help the doctor as well.
That's what I was thinking.
It's like a gang war, kind
of. Do they have cheerleaders?
They're all cheerleaders. They're self-made cheerleaders, I guess. But yes, there are varying degrees of enthusiasm. Some dress up in cosplay of the Thrashers. There is sort of like a... Yeah, he looks like a medieval knight, sort of. It's in a different style than that, but more of an Okkosian style with the glass and metallic kind of intricate shapes and stuff. But you could definitely see that it's, you know, green and white, as sort of like a half and half, and then like the black helmet and the cape, and just a Thrasher. It looks like he has some sort of very sharp, pointy type thing as the mascot. And then the Planeteer is just like I said, sort of like an orangey, yellowy glow of a sphere, and it looks if you saw different projections of maps, you can see the latitude and longitude type lines for that. As part of their symbol. And so that different... What was that?
I said, I'm just going to relay that and then just continue to listen and just kind of, you know...
Infiltrate.
Ratiate myself to everybody.
Okay. Sounds good. And Captain, let's...
What are the sports like? I mean, is it like a blood sport or is it like...
It has... you would appreciate it as an honorary blade. As part of it, but in any match that you see on any of the screens, nobody has seen anybody even touch it in the course of any of the matches. Okay. That does not mean that it's not ever used. That is known. But so it is sort of a blood sport, but it's not. Its intention isn't finality, as more as marks of victory, I guess.
Okay.
So, but yeah,
it's not like some Klingon shit.
Yeah, right.
It's not blood. It's not like to the death or anything like that. It's like it's meant as
ball.
Like what?
Laser ball.
Laser ball. To the pain. With a spoon, brother.
Where are the skaters in the?
Because it'll hurt more. You're the roller skaters. Okay, so everybody else is on roller skates. I've just changed the whole meta of this Star Trek game. Star Trek rollerblading.
I just had this vision of them doing like a roller derby with like the ball and the
I can see Worf, you know, being the bullet through there, and they're kind of slingshotting him forward and just crashing through all the Ferengi and stuff. You know,
like, that makes me want to play now. Like,
I know. All right. But hey, who knows what holodecks can do?
There's a movie called Rollerball you should see.
All right, Captain, you are trying to find a bookie.
I also kind of need to hear, you know, I'm trying to figure out, like, if there's other implications to betting. If I was to pick a team, would I be, you know, being crossing a social faux pas line for an outsider, or would I be like casting a vote with a certain group of people? Or, you know, I need to know what I'm actually getting myself into, which is why I'd want to talk to somebody who, like, you know, controlled that shit.
Okay. So how would you go about looking for said person? You know, there's four governors here. You know, one guy's exalted in sense, and those are the ones that were at your table. So
I think I'd probably talk to one of the I'd sit down with the governors and ask, like, you know, ask for their take on these games and what they imply.
Are you gonna ask the zealot one or
Which not one are first. You addressing? I'll give a brief description of the four of them. Three of them are women. One is very dark skinned, and she is someone who has been very interested in what her friend has been talking about. They seem to be of the same team, the Threshers of this area, but they it's not like it's their one of the she has the Thresher one, so you can tell that she's probably from this place, because that seems more ubiquitous here. But her friend has two of them, the Thrashers and Planeteer, so it's almost like a wash, but they seem to be co-joined in a way. But the one that was doing the betting, she was defending the Thrashers, and then the other governor was clearly one of the Planeteer excited fans. And
which one was the Zealot?
The Zealot was the other one. It was a guy. He seems very pale. Not because he's ill or anything. He just seems that he's somber sort of person. But not like sickly, ghostly white. But he's definitely pale. And he seemed to be the quiet one, just letting them speak amongst themselves. They seem to all represent different places in the area. You think Oxnard is the one that the second woman next to the dark-haired woman, she was the one defending the Thrashers, even though she also has the pin of the other ones, but she seems to represent Oxnard, which is the location of the arena, which is actually inside. So it's almost like its own place inside the larger of the domes, only because of its shape and location inside this place. And then finally, the other woman, she has a stern face. She seems much older than the other two, and her demeanor implies not anger or upsetness, but like, you don't even know what you're talking about. You just don't know. You're just ignorant children to me. And I care about you, and you're doing great, and go team, but you just don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, she sounds like the one I want to talk to, though.
And then the guy notices you, keeps his eye on you, but doesn't say anything. Yeah, and so you take a seat.
I would take a seat next to the matron.
She acknowledges you, and there's no seat per se, but one of the other ones asks the other one to move down one, and they kind of make a spot for you. Oh, and they talk amongst themselves while you talk to the older woman.
Fair enough. I would start with something along the lines of, it seems like a lot of people are invested in these games.
Ah, you're quick to observation, Captain.
Is there... Oh,
excuse me, I'm Governor Idris Mall, M-A-L-L.
Idris, I'm... Ania. Ania, that's my name. Yeah, right. It's been a long time since I've said my name.
Oh, yes. I've been got Captain into the punch, Joe. I see. Me too. You can't avoid that.
It's lovely punch you guys make here. Yes, it's Captain Ania Blazark. She's...
nice to meet you.
She's probably in her early 40s at this point. And, she's just... I guess my next comment would be something along the lines of does the game have political overtones, or is it just a recreational activity?
Oh, well, that is a good question. Insightful, I would say. Yes, it is not purely political. It is definitely for entertainment purposes only, but a lot of the people of our world really enjoy this style of sport because it's, you know, everybody's giving a part of themselves to the whole process. And even the prizes themselves are pieces of art or memorabilia from our sacred homes. These places have been our homes for centuries, and it's been an honor to have these gifts challenged amongst ourselves so that not anyone can just have the resources, but they have access to whatever their world may need. And those who are prepared for that challenge can ask for a challenge for it. And the prize itself is the most important key here. And I think it has been quite a great season for this. And the culmination to coincide with the event is going to be magnificent. And I'm looking forward to the most spectacular morning you'll ever see in this galaxy. But anyway, that's not until later. Do you have any questions? I'd love to talk to you a little bit more about this. But I guess the political ramifications are more clout, I guess, amongst our people. But overall, I think it's been very good for us overall. As a citizenry, we get bonded together in ways. You don't have to be of any particular place, but if you are, maybe your grandparents lived there, great grandparents, maybe you have an affinity for Oxnard or not, as our young friends here also agree. So it doesn't matter who you cheer for, that you're cheering is good for everybody. So it's up to you, Captain, how you see it. I will not try to persuade you one way or the other. Or the other. There's so many teams. Even you yourself and your whole crew could become part of this team, you know, up to four, because that's how the rules go in this case. But up to four of you could actually join if you had something of value to offer us occasions. And since we are going to become Federation allies very soon, perhaps that would even be a better investment in our diplomatic ties. But the Chancellor is not interested in those kind of things, but I am. So perhaps one day we can talk to the Federation in a way that will benefit both of our people. However, if you did have a representation that represented you and your crew, it would be acceptable in the match if you so choose. And that could give you quite a bit of clout as negotiations move forward with the Federation in the occasions. And if you did, and your team had the winning clout, as it were, even runners-up are praised because it takes a while to get to where you want to be. But if you wanted to assemble a team of your best, and I could see there's some already who've left recently who could fit that bill, I will just say that, you know, that is entirely up to you, but all gifts are welcome, and you are welcome to join us. Thank you. I do have an attendant thing to do.
I just had a
few more moments.
These gifts or tokens that each team brings into this, it seems that those are
their representations.
They sound like they're more than representation.
They perhaps represent the extra crop from the berry farmers from the West. And perhaps the ore abundance that we've had recently could be settled in your place so that your mines can churn out such great metals and works of art as other places. And so everybody has a chance to receive something, and it's for our own benefit to share the wealth, as it were, with anything that goes above and beyond what we have a need for in our towns. So the sport is kind of a mix of multiple different things, but it's mostly an honor system, and it works out pretty good for us.
Yeah, it sounds like it works out pretty good for you because you're always winning and therefore get the first culling of all.
No, that's not how that works. No. I believe the most precious gift is the first chosen, and not necessarily the most wealthy gift or the most opulent or resource-wise. Everyone is fed, everyone is bathed, everyone has a chance to enjoy paradise here in this place. And so it's not an exclusivity thing. It's just a timing thing. It takes time for everybody to be here. We all went here all at once. It would be mobbed and subdued, and the natural beauty of this place would be submerged by a mass of people and tents and whatnot, which is has been happening in the past. But we've decided that it was important to make sure everybody has something, and so we go with that as our mentality.
So when you say here, what do you mean here? This city?
Yeah, this city here. Yeah, each city and each place has its own resources and connection to the planet. All right, I'm going to leave
but
that
this one is
there.
Thriving.
They all seem to be thriving. They are all thriving. I'm going to pause now, and that was quite a bit of conversation, so that's probably enough to run down a long hallway, perhaps run a scan or two, and so I'm gonna say it's the top of the new round of everybody getting a chance to do something. So I'm going to go back to Maniri and Pixrin. You're going to notice that this next round, there's already people at the door opening the door for them, but they're looking in your direction. So you know that your approach, at least for some of them, will be noticed, even if you don't sprint. They notice you're there, because you are currently running, and if you wanted to jump behind something, I might give you a chance to be secret about it, but they don't seem alarmed. They just happen to be looking in your direction.
As you pointed out, we have sort of been, or at least I have been known for running around places, so.
That's fine, and you are going to a common area where there's a tram station.
Yeah.
Where more people can get to, and so they're not making any deal out of it, but it's not.
So I saw them seeing us, so I'm just going to kind of turn to Pixarin and kind of converse and, you know, make it look like we're just doing our own thing.
Well, yeah. I mean, Pixarin has pretty good fitness and daring, so I can probably kind of keep up with Minera's curiosity and running around thing. So I'll just she'll just probably follow her lead. We're both security, so I'll just follow Minera and her stuff.
Cool.
Having a girl's night running around.
Yeah, that's what we do.
Jogging.
Right. So what are you guys doing? You're just are you sprinting again, or
no? We're just jogging.
You sprinted to get to here, but
right.
By the time you got here, you're like, "Oh, we're just running along." I don't know what you're talking about.
Running along, talking.
Casual jog through the promenade area, wherever. So that's fine. Do you want to? I think I'm going to have you roll to see how nonchalant you really end up being.
Okay.
but I will make it a. I'll make it security-based.
And I have to say that, you know, after hearing
maybe presence security, yeah, you can give off the guise of being just hanging out.
Okay.
And I think both of you need to roll independent roles.
Percy's laying on my character sheet.
Because I also have composure, so I can kind of...
Yeah, that could be a focus for sure.
Go ahead. Yeah, you take the lead on this one.
You're both doing it independently because you both have to act cool.
Oh, okay. All right, cool. But so presence security with composure. I have that one too, so we can both do
the
same.
Both have the focus available. So your composure has come in handy. You've been in these situations before, and you're tailing somebody, but somebody's looking, so you're not really tailing somebody. So
what is the difficulty?
It'll be a difficulty one.
Okay.
They don't seem alarmed or alerted or unusual to see you guys running around. Yeah, especially Maniri, so.
Just be part of our mystique, you know? They, like, think we're cool and we're, like, run around.
They live around everywhere.
I had 2 successes.
All right. And so you gain 1 momentum. So you're now back up to 2.
Yay.
And go ahead and roll for
Pixarin.
Pixarin?
Yeah, I have to say, as a side, after hearing about the maps and hearing about the governor talking, I'm suddenly picturing the map like a Catan board for some reason. It's like the ore and the, you know, like the berries.
Not quite like that. Because you know, the city's big enough to have a couple different biomes in it. So it's not quite like that. But yeah, you can sort of like that. But all right. So you'll be 2d20 and then some of your presence security.
Presence and security?
Yep. And then security would be the 5 or 4, whatever one you have.
Why would he be 2d20? Wasn't an area 2d20?
It's not an assist. It's a composure roll, basically. You're trying to act cool.
Are you rolling on our own?
Roll casual.
If you want to spend an extra, well, you've already rolled.
That shouldn't be 2 complications, but it was 0 successes. I'm not sure why it took your complication range like that. But you rolled an 18, 17. You didn't roll a 20, so that doesn't count. But still 0 successes. As you're running along, Mineri, you're just running. You've been running this whole time. And Pixarin is running along with you, but it doesn't seem like, I mean, you're both running at the same pace and everything's working out, but it just seems that I'm not going to call it a complication, but both of you notice that the ones that are facing you give a nod to the Chancellor and like I'm motioning to them to look over their shoulder, and which he does and notices you approaching, and he doesn't try to turn or do anything, but he stands there and waits for you to approach. And you're standing in front of him.
Is he near the tram or anything? Like, what?
It's the entrance to the building that goes to the tram, yeah.
And the tram would take us back to our quarters and...
Potentially, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I just kind of say, oh, Chancellor, and do the little bow thing.
He does the same thing in return.
I thought we'd go and change into some more casual clothes for the festivities, and we're looking forward to the sports ball game for sure.
Yeah, Bayul. Yeah, that's
yeah, Bayul. Cool.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, of course. You know, I was almost to my private tram, but yes, you're welcome to enjoy the festivities at your leisure, and so thankful for your and your crew's presence here. Really look forward to chatting later. I'm sure the captain would be anxious to chat as well.
I just kind of go, is this the way to the public tram, or is this the way, are we going the right way?
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Good question. If you just enter the building and to the right, you can follow the orange lines and it'll take you to the beach.
Oh, to the right. Pixarin. Sorry.
Yes. And then there are other attachments to the left as privates, and also long distance ones to the other places. So, but you're welcome to... go wherever you like, just stay within the city systems, and you'll be doing great. So,
all right, thank you.
All right, thank you. Have a good day. And he rushes off.
See you
off.
For some drinks later.
Yeah. Pleasure.
As we move off, I want to whisper to Pixarin, just, you getting anything?
Yeah, I was just going to say what Pixarin sensed.
Yeah, I was just going to I hope that I kind of like... glossed over the fact that we were kind of following him with the whole like, oh, is this not the tram?
Yeah, he was Pixar notices after the nod, basically, when you were approaching, he was genuinely surprised to see you. Like, I thought I left and there you are. But you mentioned, you know, you start talking about stuff, you kind of, you know, it's like, okay, whatever, I guess, just going the same way, I guess. And so he just kind of brushes it off or whatever. I think to see if he truly brushes it off, I'm going to have you roll, I guess, present security again, or presence command, whichever one seems good for you. It's an opposed roll, and so I'm going to have a roll for my character as well. And so We will see.
Would I be able to give
I will let you have an assist? Instead? I don't know. I guess Pixen could signal to Maneri that, yes, indeed, your question is true. There is something. And then follow my lead sort of thing, you know. All right. So that, okay. And you do have two momentum to spend and plenty of threat to give me to get more dice in this roll. Because it is contested, I'm going to be spending 3 threat for more dice.
I guess we have 2 momentum. I'll go ahead.
1 momentum will get you 1 die, and 1 momentum and 1 threat will get you a 2nd die.
Okay. I think I'm just going to do the 1 momentum.
No, let's go for it. This could be
okay, I guess we're going for it. We'll do the momentum and threat, and do 2 more dice.
Be bold.
Be bold.
Be bold.
All right, so we got that. So let me, okay, so reformulate your roll. It was like 4d20 now. And then, so Pixran, be minus 2m.
Now, why are you going 11? What was his two, his attribute and his discipline?
His presence and security, or presence and command?
Either one.
Okay, never mind. Hold on, let me change that.
All right, so you're out of momentum, and I'm at 7 threat. 13.
Thank you.
Okay. That seems more plausible. And then, also, Maneri, you can assist in this with a 1d20. You formulate your role, but go ahead and roll Pixrin.
Rolling.
It's a 40, 20, 13, 4. If you want to
just move. Real quick, does my cautious security do anything for me at all?
Because you spent a momentum to buy an extra die, you can have a reroll of one of your dice on this roll.
All right, I'll use that in case I get a fumble.
I like it.
Yeah.
3 successes.
And you can reroll the 18 if you like. So just do the same thing with 1d20 instead.
Good job.
Okay. 1 success. 4 successes.
Okay, Maneri, roll yours.
So was mine resistance? Correct? I don't get a focus thing because I'm not the lead, correct? So it's just 1d20 and then my...
It's 1d20, but you security. Have a focus that might apply.
Do I have a focus that I might apply here? Got I was it. Thinking of my xenoanthropology, kind of trying to read what their attitude.
Well, you have been studying and you've had read reports already from the doctor and the commander. Yeah. Yeah. I will allow it to be a focus this time.
So it'd be 1D.
I'll do a focus.
So, like,
cost.
You're reading their body
so
language?
I would,
is that what you mean?
Increase your complication range by 1. So make it 19 instead.
1D, so 20. 14.
14, 2.
14 and whatever your number is for your
or 14.
Security. Yeah. Command. And then a 19 at the end of that.
19. Okay. Thank you. 1 success.
Still got one. So 3, 4, 5 successes total.
Right on.
All right. So I get to roll down. And so I've already spent 3 threat from 2 extra die. All right.
Taping. 4 successes, 1 complication.
And then I'm going to spend a threat for a reroll. I think it's 2 threat.
I don't know, you could do a complication on yourself, say. Man.
And all this just to bluff him? Just to give him the... The height that we're not really following.
Well, we want to read some more of what they're reading into us, I think, as far as part of this.
So. Well, I can only reroll 1 dice. So,
wait a minute. If you've already got 4, if you rolled 4 dice and got 4 successes,
I can reroll the 20, get rid of the complication.
Complication, yeah.
And still have a chance to get another one success to tie. Or two.
How do you get an extra success with four dice?
Under his critical range. He's got the same things we do. Yeah.
So one extra success. So that 20 turns into a 7. And then the 4, yeah, which is 2 successes. And then the 8 and 11 and the 7 are 3 other. So a 5 and 5. However, in this case, and I will be glad to let you know.
They're shrewd.
He is the chancellor of this whole place, so he has been around the block.
They just ran around the block.
I'm going to give you this. I'm going to give you this because it's a tie. Generally, the tie goes to the ones who implement the action. And in this case, it was your team. And therefore, I will give you the tiebreaker. So this is what happens, and we'll go from there. We are approaching towards the end of our session time, so I did want to make sure that everybody gets another chance. So we'll finish with you all and we'll go from there. So Chancellor Akim, he looks at you curiously, like, that is an unbelievable story, but for some reason I believe it. You know, it's just like, okay, you're just you're new here, I guess, that's whatever. So they don't even notice. Let him go through and you, I assume, start running.
Well, you start running towards the tram.
Your tram. And you take a right, and it's exactly as we described it. And the last thing you see out of the corner of your eye as you turn the corner is him shaking his head, and his assistant's like, I don't know, sir, kind of thing. And they just kind of, all of them in an ensemble kind of dome their way or circle their way towards a side area. And there's, you know, you can see other, you know, passageways and doorways and stuff. And they go down one of those as you kind of lose sight of them. But you're now in the public area where you can go anywhere you want to now that they're not in sight anymore.
I'll rejoin the commander and then once we get to that area.
And we can kind of send our little report of what happened.
Okay. Doctor, did you want to finish up your investigation, at least in this area? As you're, I don't know what you're doing next, but are you returning back to the rest of the crew to report? So I assume you're sending it as you...
Yes, as I can definitely, as I'm moving. I mean, we're, you know, there's not much else I can pick up where I was at. I seem to be getting the gist of what the biological differences are of the area.
Okay.
And I'm wanting to, I feel like I'm not going to be able to really get good scans until the ship shows up. So I'm looking to try to...
You said you were going to communicate or try to communicate with the ship?
Yeah. See if the ship's within range to actually see how long it is till it's
in orbit. You get a chirp on your comm badge that says that communication lines are open.
Oh, excellent. Are you in scanning range of the planet?
Hello, this is the USS Medusa. This is... sorry. They lost their name. One moment, a name appears in front of you. This is Captain Caveman. Yurio, Captain Yurio.
Captain Yurio. Oh, okay. I'm talking to the captain.
Wow. First try.
Yeah.
Yeah. She sounds not gruff, but gravelly voice, I guess. Yeah. Hey. What do you want? Who's this again?
Hello, Captain. This is Dr. Sihl. Lieutenant Commander.
Dr. Sihl of, yes. I've read your,
soon to be
records.
Of the Medusa.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. No, I know who you are. I know who you are.
Oh, very good. We're,
What is the pleasure, Doctor?
We are going through some diplomatic, function stuff down here with the local residents and...
Oh, that has begun already. Okay.
Yes.
We were hoping to be part of the festivities, but alas, we'll have to, hand the ball off to you when we get there. Looks like we're about a few... I mean, we can get to there in any moment, but we're going to cruise in, sublight, be there in about 3 hours at the most. But there's some interesting anomalies up here. So we're just going to take a look at, see what's going on. But yeah, Captain, can we help you with something?
What kind of anomalies are you seeing up there?
Oh, yes. It seems like the sun is having some high energy fluctuation a little bit. It's not massive at this point, but it does seem to be increasing slowly.
Does it appear to be
we'll give it an eye on it, and we'll let you know if anything else changes.
Does it appear to be any kind of energy bursts that are headed towards the planet?
We haven't done those calculations, but I'm sure we can get somebody to do that right away.
There is some strange, well, it may be nothing, but there's some strange history going on here on the planet, and obviously there's some history of high solar radiation causing some ill effects on the population.
The previous sorry for interrupting. Starfleet expeditions there reported something similar to that. It is pretty strange, but we haven't really figured out necessarily what they used it for or whatever.
Well, we're keeping our eye on some upcoming games that they have, and there's I don't know, we're getting some mixed signals from the Chancellor here that there's some kind of problem that they're going to need us for in a few hours. Not sure what this involves or both my investigations are going down the right path at all, but I'm just interested in getting some scans of you'll notice that the central area where the city is that we're on right now has been heavily altered. You'll notice that the outside of the borders of the city, there's a difference in the biology. There's a difference in the composition of the animals and the fauna and everything. And I'm curious.
Curious adaptation.
Definitely. And then if the ship sensors were available at the time when you're able to come into orbit, I would love to be able to task them with getting some scans of the local population and see if there's any large differences or there's heavy solar activity. I'm sure we don't want to know about that too.
I'll make sure that the sensors information is sent down to your tricorder. Is the captain with you at the moment, Doctor?
Not with me at the moment. He was diplomatic duties back at the...
I'll contact them independently then. So we have the shuttle that you arrived in, I presume, coming up to meet the Medusa. And so the command staff will make the transfer on planet after we arrive from the shuttle. The Medusa, on the other hand, will continue to do scans of the sun, and also including the perhaps more of the planet like you were describing, to see if there's some sort of correlation that we can discover. We can coordinate that from up there with your science team. I'm sure we can get in within transporter range, at least briefly, to get a team or two up or down as needed, but that's up to your captain's discretion. Was there anything the Medusa could do for you at this moment?
No, thank you very much, and I hope you have smooth sailing on the rest of your way here.
I was hoping for a scenic tour around this beautiful planet one last time in the Medusa. It's been a fine ship. So, yeah, anyway, sorry, waxing nostalgic. You're doing good work, Doctor. I'm sure you'll make a fine CMO. I will see you on planet side soon.
Oh, word out.
Beep, beep. Understood. Here we go.
Beep, beep.
And the Doctor, what are you going to do after chatting?
I guess the only thing to do is just to get back towards the rest of the group, see if anybody got anything of worth, and
collate information kind of thing?
Collate information, yeah.
Sure. Calvin or Captain, do you have a specific scene that you want to keep going with? Or we can make it a wrap up.
Is that lady still talking your ear off, Captain?
Well, she said she does have another engagement, so they only have a few more minutes to talk. But you're welcome. She and all the rest of the governors are going to get up and start mingling and stuff. But you're welcome to walk with them as they're leaving. The party's starting to shift back out to the outdoors, and the top people are kind of leaving, and the novelty crew you have seem to have left already too. You know, even though your ears are quite interesting, and
I'm nowhere near as interesting as a cat.
Not as quite as a large furry. Anyway, so
so I do have a question.
For a big furry.
What's that?
That's right.
What'd you say, Calvin?
Oh, I was saying because Casey's character is a strong green woman.
That's right.
Oh, right. Pixren and Mimir are definitely.
Yeah. Incredible.
Okay, but I would, as you know, as we're getting up and everything, I would say something along the lines of, it seems like there's some of you are more focused on the celebration after the game than the game. What type of celebration is this, anyways?
Oh, well, this is a rare event for our people. You know, in the past, we've had different encounters with our sun. It gets kind of active sometimes, and our scientists are well in the front of all of this. And so every year, approximately about this time, at varying degrees of intensity, there's some brilliant fireworks in the sky, meteorites and ions and stuff like that, creating these brilliant auroras and sparkles in the sky. And it's just we've basically centered our joyful tournament to culminate during this event, so that by the time even some teams have just been dumbstruck with the awe and beauty of it, and you know, may have lost a match. So it has its own play in our matches sometimes, and so you know, it's just the feeling of culmination of just a completion of a cycle, as it were. And you know, that's, we really like doing that kind of stuff. Wow. Yeah. So
how like big a cycle? How long has this been going on?
For centuries. Yeah, it's been.
So is this a culmination of centuries, or is this?
Well,
how often has it culminated? I guess. kind of a cycle does this? Does this? What kind of a cycle are we culminating in right now?
Hello, what are we cycling with?
Heyo, how many times did they culminate?
As many as possible. Okay.
I mean,
so
you were just talking about it being a.
It's like a regular event. Cycle. So. Though the peaks vary year to year, it's usually this week, but definitely
tomorrow.
We can time when the final is going to be, and you know, it doesn't always fall exactly when the peak is. But either way, it's, you know, it's a culmination event, and happens every year. Some years are more spectacular than others, and so it's been really. Wonderful to be able to celebrate again year after year, and I'm honored to serve my people and to make sure that the games go on as we've always done. So
fantastic.
Anyway, thank you for chatting. It's good to learn more about you, and at least in our conversations and questions you've had. But we'll chat later. I'm sure you wouldn't want to miss the finals, I'm sure. So anyway, one way or the other, whether you're participating or not, is entirely up to you. But it's been a pleasure, and we look forward to seeing you soon.
Wow. They want us to play. What are the rules of this silly game?
Well, we're...
I hope there's a lot of jogging.
I have a big download if we want to sit around and like look it all over and see.
Yeah, let's say...
Yeah, let's do that next time.
We'll do the whole culmination thing. I'll make it either a write-up or a quick way to summarize some of your questions.
They're trying to talk us into playing.
And so we're going to leave this sort of, it's not a cliffhanger, but it's a to be continued You are find yourself back at your designated. You're in the same building, basically, but different floors and rooms. And so, depending on when you arrive back, the tram system, Maneri and Fixrin get back before all y'all.
I think we're gonna like look around while we're
doing that, you can do security sweeps and stuff like that, and I'll just be a general presence and awareness kind of thing. So
we'll jog around waving the queen wave to our fans, and
your fans
checking stuff while they're not looking.
They would love to. Autographs and stuff.
So. There's already teenage girls wearing cat ears and painting their faces green.
That's right. You become superstars overnight. So you always are gonna seem to be getting attention no matter where you are. And even having a whiff of what the governor spoke about with the captain from inside the hall, cascading throughout the whole area. It has been rumored that Maneri and Pixran and all of the crew, one way or another, are going to be participating in this year's event as a special guest or something.
Maybe that's why they're jogging around.
They're exercising, getting ready for it. But it seems like the rumor mill is going. But I'm going to say that you all have joined back together. I'll give you a few moments to surmise and give information based on each other's stock, but you can cross-talk what you want to. But I just want to give everybody a chance to say a little bit more about what their character's thinking and what data they think is relevant to what the hell's going on. So let's go ahead and do that at, say, Captain's, like, a side conference room available for you all.
Commander Calvin, What you got?
Pretty much I've just been kind of getting into I've been trying to figure out what the significance of the game is and the outcome of the game. It seems like it's more than just an allocation and a way to distribute resources across different cities. I think it's definitely a way for them to keep a little bit more order between the different areas. It seems like the cities are kind of independent and not like totally independent, but fairly independent of each other. And I think there's something that's going to come out of this game that nobody really wants to discuss with us that's going to be after the game. Like there's something that that goes after that's going to kind of be a little bit bigger than I think they're letting on. Or to them, it's not no big deal, but to us, it might be a big deal. Especially if they're coming into to be part of the Federation. We need to know if they have these like huge regime changes that could counter what Starfleet wants, you know? So we have to kind of look at what this whole thing's all about and see if it is something that's going to affect not just the planet, but if they're part of Starfleet, is that going to affect Starfleet? If they have big regime changes every 10 years or something, then, you know, we might have to be like, yeah, your regime changes can happen, but this is the way it's got to stay for us. So no matter what happens on your planet, as far as Starfleet's concerned, you know, so just kind of looking at the negotiation side of this whole admitting them into Starfleet, I'm kind of a little iffy since they're keeping it so tight-lipped and they definitely seem like they're not wanting to fully discuss everything. And if this is just a game and there's just a party afterwards, there shouldn't be a reason that they're being so apprehensive about letting us know what's going on with this game and after the game. So that's my thoughts on it. And I've just been kind of milling around, getting endearing myself to people to see if I can glean any more of this, but it doesn't seem like I got any more than that.
Thank you. Thank you. And Maneri, how'd it go?
Well, I'm very curious about this because the information that Pixrin and you, Captain, have been getting, like, in your little woo-woo minds there, it seems to be that they want our help, the Chancellor and the Assistant. And yet, it seems quite clear that the Chancellor at least, doesn't want to be seen associating with us. So maybe there's some kind of way they want our help, but without others knowing that they want it. And I'm wondering, did we notice any like team colors on the assistant or the chancellor at all? Like, did they have anything that they displayed?
If it was there, it was subdued. Maybe it was just, it didn't seem like they were, he was seemed very neutral colors.
Right, but the assistant, maybe?
I will let you roll a memory roll. Let's see, as a security officer, I'll give you security. Let's see, there's a couple different options. Either insight or reason, probably, but maybe control, because that's, control's doing something though.
Insight, I would think.
Insight, I think would probably, insight security, to see if you can recall anything. Does anybody want to assist? Who is who is with the, or talked to the chancellor the most? I mean, I guess Pictron could also do that, because they saw, you both saw them twice.
Yeah, Pictron has that too. So
I'd say Pictron could assist for the same insight security. I'm going to say it's been a while. It wasn't really a remarkable thing necessarily anyway. I saw it, call it difficulty 3. And I will throw 2 threat to increase the complication range by 2.
Can I use my xenoanthropology again for, because I was kind of studying their culture-y stuff and what, you know, you said the colors were there and lots of people, but subtle. And I was studying what's going on. So can I use my...
Oh, yeah, I remember that conversation.
Xenoanthropology.
Because a lot of the stuff that you've already been doing, ensemble, and then, you know, everybody has all the data in your pads in front of you now. You're having the conversation right now. And Maneri's trying to remember off the top of her head, his head, what that would be. And Pixarin's like, you know, maybe wearing this and doing this, and maybe that's a symbol or whatever.
I think that's what I'll be rolling.
Were they in any of the 3D pictures that you guys were getting taken?
Oh, the selfies.
As you recall,
that was after they
on some of the other
other
people's
that.
Little device.
That was after they left.
All right.
Well, it's probably been happening the whole time you've been here, so
That's true.
Just didn't notice them until recently. All right, do you have a focus, perhaps, that Pictron would have that might apply to either memory or surveillance or that kind of thing?
I don't think so. I wasn't. Well, I've got infiltration, and let's see, infiltration, survival, and cultural studies are the only ones that might have
anything. I'd let you have cultural studies. In this case, because it is really, in this case, it seems important to them.
That's under science, right?
It's a security check.
Okay.
Insight security. Do you want to give me threat for an extra die? Difficulty 3.
What do we have for how many?
We don't have any momentum.
And 3 threat.
We have no momentum.
So we could give you 2 threat and get 1 die? Is that how it works?
You gave me 1. It's the same as momentum. So 1 for 1 die, 2 more for second
one.
Die.
Well, let's do 1 for 1, guys.
For 1. Yeah. So if you, you give me 1 threat for. Okay. Yeah.
So that'd be 3d, 20, 13,
5. Yeah, we still need 3 success. You still need 3 successes, though.
And well Pixarin is assisting.
Is there any way to gain another die without really overdoing it? Since somebody throw
let's just do 1.
No, it's the end of the night. I mean, can somebody throw their...
It is the end of the night. You can use your... does somebody have a value that might apply?
Insatiable curiosity.
That I would give you that. As. but what that would do is cost an extra threat, because that's 1 die bought as automatic critical success, and then the second die costs 2, and the third die costs 3. So you already have 1, so I'm going to increase that for the extra die. But you do have, I will let you use that value, and make sure you write that down somewhere or remember it that you use that value. And also remember, Calvin used a value last time, and so we can talk about that too.
Why do we need to note that?
You know, I got talents. I just have the cautious security. I don't know if that is anything, but
not as an assist though. But it would apply if you were the lead.
Compassion.
That would allow you to But it's cautious, you said? No, it wouldn't be, because you'd have to spend momentum to get a die, and you didn't have any momentum, so it would be moot right now.
Blackbrand, can you remind me why we note those? Is it because we can only use them once during an episode?
Or it's, remember I was telling you about character advancement and stuff?
Oh, yeah.
So if you, for every time you use the same value at a different time, referring to this event that you're trying to do or whatnot, in regards to the study or the understanding of the occasions and stuff like that. But I think in this case, it would be good to remember which one it is. So then the next time you do it, it'd be if you do it a second time using the same value in some sort of related way, then that's called an arc, and that allows you an opportunity to increase or change around some of your stuff. And okay. If you do it a second time later on, say in another episode after that, and also use the same value or whatnot, then that would be called a story arc. And then you can add a new value or add a new department point or attribute point or something like that. And so awesome. That's how you get to control how your character develops. And so depending on which values you are most using or wanting to use, and if you use them, you know, concurrently, that allows you and your character to develop in the way most likely that fits the values that you're trying to espouse for your
game. Okay, thank you. All right, that makes sense too about why, that's kind of why I have that xenoanthropology, is because I'm super curious about other people's, some stuff from my background went with that too. So yeah, okay, that makes sense.
Okay, so right, you cool, bought an extra die.
Yep.
And you also have the two automatic successes. So you have a 3d20 now. And then also, what was the Pixren's security value?
Wasn't it cultural?
Pixren, the one that we're using, I think was cultural studies.
Yes, that was
it. Yeah, I was going to allow us cultural studies. Yeah, because this is, in this case, it actually has an importance that you would be aware of. You know, you're Pixren is very good at security and understanding the situation, and every detail counts, basically.
All right. So what's Nikki
going to roll? Should I go ahead and roll 3d20?
Yep.
I got two successes.
And a complication.
And a complication. Dun, dun, dun.
All right. And then go ahead.
No chance to re-roll. One success, three successes.
So you got three successes plus the two successes for five successes with your determination and one complication. So you gain two momentum.
Do we want to spend those to get rid of that complication?
And so you have five. So you have two gained momentum. You can quash the complication with those two and it'll be a wash, but it's a success regardless.
I think we should, because I don't think we get to carry them over to the next gaming session. Yes, no.
We start next.
Start fresh next.
Fresh next time. I would allow you to carry over your whatever pools we have. Or
because we're still in the same.
But we're still in the same thing. But it will be a new scene, so it'll be minus one momentum either way, because it just a change of scene.
Might as well.
Chapter, I guess.
Yeah, might as well do it.
Yeah, do
we're
it.
We're going to ditch that complication with
okay,
those.
Okay, so no momentum gained or lost, and no threat gained or lost. So three successes is three successes versus a difficulty three. That means that you talk about it, you think about it, and for some reason there's something out of place that both of you notice. And you didn't notice it because of the stressful nature of your encounter, kind of. Okay. Like, you just got caught and just trying to...
Can I just say where I was going with this? Sure. If where I was going with asking about their team colors was that if they want us to help them by actually being part of the game thing, we could go in for that team, potentially. You know what I'm saying? We help them by giving them prestige by doing our athletic shit and, like... Operating. We could pick the most athletic among the team here and, like, do our best. And yeah. So did we find out in doing this whether we know if the assistant or we could do some research with the assistant and the chancellor have an affinity with a certain team, or, you know, that's where I was going with it.
Okay. Go ahead. What the two of you remember, and both of you look at each other and go, did you actually see that? And you're like, yeah, I actually saw that. And like, I can't believe we actually saw that. So what you're going to see on the assistant, and this is the end of what we're going to talk about tonight and end our session together. So I want to thank all of you for being here tonight and enjoying our game together. And I hope you all feel better for next time. And so we're going to leave tonight's episode with a strange and interesting mystery. As you recall and you recount to your team, you swear by all that is holy of the Federation that this woman, the assistant, not only had something for the Thrashers, which seems to be the local colors for administrative district, but you swear that you saw the Starfleet emblem right next to it. All right, thanks everybody. I hope you have a good night, and we will see you next time. All right, I love you guys. Blessed be.
Doctor.
Commander, Captain.
Doctor.
Lieutenant Commander.
Hi, everybody.
Good night, everybody. Heal up.